good afternoon. Welcome on behalf of the Bloomington Bob Cantata Project. I'm Dan Milan, the director. We present, as you know, performances of cantatas by J.S. Bach in presentations modeled on his own, using texts and inversions and the performing forces based on what we know about how he presented these works in his time. Together, of course, with an opportunity to learn something about these pieces, and between the two performances you'll get a chance to hear, this is a musical experience I think you really cannot get anywhere else. I have a couple of announcements to start with. First of all, there's one more performance in our regular season. That's a month from now, Sunday, March 27th. Chris Kwapis will direct Loben in Helm, den mächtigen König der Ehren, BWV 137. And besides getting a chance to hear that splendid piece, we have something planned that has probably not been heard since Bach's day in the presentation of this piece. So you come find out what that is. And I'm very pleased to announce that this season we will have a seventh performance by the Cantata Project here in Bloomington. We have been invited to perform at the Bloomington Early Music Festival. And our performance will be Sunday evening, May 22nd. Excuse me. That's the opening night of the festival. Carol Ann Buff, who I saw here a minute ago, will direct Es ist euch gut, dass ich hingehe, BWV 108. That's a cantata on a text by Bach's only female known librettist, Christiane Mariana von Ziegler, in honor of the festival's theme this year of women in early music. So you can look for further publicity and announcements in connection with the festival and see the entire program for the festival, which is going to be free and open to the public, and present an astonishing variety of really interesting music. Note that when it comes time for you to attend our performance at the opening of the festival, we're going to be at a different time on the Sunday and in a different place, so it will not be here at 2:30, but keep your eyes out for that. So the work of the Bloomington Bach Cantata Project is made possible by the generous support of donors. And today marks the beginning of our fundraising effort for next season, which will be our 13th season here in Bloomington. We have been fortunate enough to raise enough money to support full seasons for the last 12 years. Presenting a 13th depends once again on our having enough financial support. We've made a good start. We've had some very generous donations toward next year's programs, but we need more. And I'm here to ask for your support as well toward a 13th season of Bach Cantatas here at the BBCP. If you are able, this is the time to make a donation toward next season. We do our fundraising in advance of the season so that we know that we have the resources to present these pieces in the way that we want. You can make a donation by check. The address to which to send it is in the program. You can use the donate button on the BBCP Facebook page. Everybody who enjoys these concerts will be grateful for your support. Our routine, as you probably know if you've been with us before, is to hear a performance of today's cantata, a short talk about it, and then a second performance of the same piece. And I say this every time, but I think it's important. We hope that in that second performance, you'll hear new and different things. Thank you and welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Garten ist mein Ghetto schon.
Good afternoon. Welcome again. I started a talk last fall with a quip that Christmas had come a little early here at the Bach Cantata Project. That was when we did BWV 40, a cantata for the second day of Christmas in early November. I guess Christmas is staying a little late this year because today's piece, Cantata 121, is for that same liturgical date. That is the second of the 3 days over which Christmas was celebrated liturgically. Now, this might not strike a modern listener as obviously a Christmas piece. The hymn it's based on, Christumgesund Loben schon, was actually dropped a few years ago from the modern German Lutheran hymnal. It's in the modern English Lutheran hymnal as From East to West, From Shore to Shore, but I get the impression it's not an especially well-known tune even today, and thus doesn't signal Christmas, obviously, unless you know the tune and the text and the repertory pretty well. Neither does the cantata libretto as a whole suggest Christmas to the extent you might expect. It emphasizes Mary. It describes John the Baptist leaping in Elizabeth's womb. That event is associated with the Feast of the Visitation, one of the Marian observances. That was July 2nd in Bach's Lutheran world. It refers also a little bit later to indirectly to the Feast of the Presentation or the Purification. That's another Marian remembrance, February 2nd. It does mention the manger and implies the ship presence of the shepherds, but it's much less concerned with the nativity story than with theology around it. It makes, frankly, for some tough going in the libretto. We have the purchase of flesh by flesh as a metaphor for the Christian's belief in the meaning of Jesus' life and death. We have the indwelling of Jesus in the heart of the believer. We have God's mercy installed in Mary's undefiled body. And we have the image of a heart with a trembling closed lip. The modern reader and listener might then be forgiven if the language and messages of this cantata seem a little obscure, and if the connection to Christmas isn't obvious. Or, frankly, if to the modern listener and reader, the celebratory character of this piece for the second day of Christmas seems hidden. In fact, I'd suggest that there's a tension here between celebration and solemnity, between affect and doctrine, between joy and something more serious. And we can trace that tension throughout the cantata. Now, this piece is from Bach's second annual cycle that he composed and performed in Leipzig. And like most of that not quite complete set, it's based on a seasonal or topical hymn. Here, of course, the hymn is Christumgesunden Loben schon, an adaptation of a much older Latin hymn, A Solis Ortus Cardine. And that hymn, in its original form, many, many stanzas, narrates Jesus' entire life. The first verses of A Solis Ortus Cardine were translated and adapted to make a German hymn, but only the earliest verses, and those early verses are on the nativity topic, and that's how this became a Christmas tune in Lutheran usage. The hymn first appeared in print in 1524. That makes it part of the very earliest layer of Lutheran hymns. In fact, this German text is by and the melodic adaptation are by Martin Luther himself. And that turns out to be significant. Typically for these cantatas, the opening and closing stanzas of the hymn are retained. The internal stanzas are paraphrased into modern poetry, designed to be set as equally modern recitatives and arias. And those arias, to start with, show that tension I mentioned. The first of them, the aria, movement number 2, it's in an active triple meter. It's got a florid oboe and vocal line, both with elements of virtuosity in each of those lines. And those admittedly contribute to the celebratory character of the piece for Christmas. But the B section of this aria speaks of humankind as despised and lowly and destined for eternal ruin. Musically, the movement's in a minor key. It's got several musical emblems of what I might call insistence, and they go together grammatically with the commands, the imperatives in the text. Begreife nicht, do not try to comprehend. Bewundere nur, just marvel. Put as imperatives, put as commands. This is altogether a theologically involved topic in this aria. Marveling at, rather than trying to comprehend, God's fleshly purchase of sinner's salvation by Jesus' flesh. And it's put in fairly stern terms. It's a beautiful aria to be sure, but I hear a clash of the celebratory character of the event for which it was written with the theological complexity, abstractness, and insistence, maybe even a hint of darkness that goes with this text and its setting. The aria number four, the second aria in this cantata, a stunning piece for bass and string ensemble, has a starting point clearly in John the Baptist's joyful leaping in the womb. And some of the musical elements point to the joyful affect, the busy string texture, the florid vocal line, and so on. But I would say that the musical type here is at least ambiguous. A bass aria like this with coloratura and emphatic declamation, including that splendid cadence of the first vocal period. Now, that kind of writing is actually more closely associated, especially for a bass voice, with a rage aria. In this aria as well, there are musical emblems of insistence, that is, phrases played or sung or both on successively higher pitches, the so-called ascending sequence. Also, notice the B section's Brinsky Stringen, the reference to fervently pressing forward. The heart presses on from the world to Jesus in the manger. That's a metaphor, it turns out, of an urgent turning away from earthly things to Jesus. Again, I think we can hear some tension here between the celebratory and the serious. Now, this aria is introduced in a very striking way. Its key is miles away from the other movements in the cantata. The opening chorus, sort of F-sharp Phrygian mode, and the first aria in B minor clearly establish a sort of key center or area for the piece. But this aria is in C major. Again, after F-sharp Phrygian and B minor, we have an aria in C major. That's considered quite far away in tonal terms. Now, the recit that connects that aria with this one starts ordinarily enough, but the end refers to God choosing Mary's pure body as a temple of his honor, thereby, it says, in wondrous fashion, turning himself toward humankind. And the recitative takes a completely unpredictable turn itself at that moment. It's wrenched into an entirely unrelated key from where it's been by a kind of musical pun. If you want to know the technicalities, the E sharp in the bass is reinterpreted as F natural. As E sharp, it has context in the keys of the first two movements and of most of the recitative, but as the pitch F, which it's essentially equivalent to, it relates to the key of the new aria, and Bach's sudden shift emphasizes this wondrous turn described in the text. It's a stunning moment. The last stanza of the chorale, as you heard in the closing movement, is a typical simple harmonization of our tune with melody and the soprano. It's got the three lower voices moving together with the soprano in a supporting harmonization for the most part, and instrumental doubling of the four vocal lines with no independent material. Now, that closing chorale is introduced in turn by the recitative number five. It makes a clear Christmas reference to angel choirs and expresses its intent to make a joyful song of praise heard, immediately followed by the chorale. This is another one of these libretto self-referential gestures reinforced by the music. The chorale, this musical setting by Bach that we hear, is that song of praise referred to a little bit more abstractly in the world of the text. And in fact, the last stanza of this chorale is a so-called doxology, a song of praise, exactly the sort of poem, the sort of prayer, the sort of song called for in the recitative text. But that chorale, that song of praise, that doxology that realizes the recitative's call for a song of praise is somewhat complicated, I would say, by the character of the tune. It's an old modal hymn. It's more or less in the Phrygian mode. It would not have been as heard as joyful and celebratory in the early 18th century when Bach adapted and used this very old tune. There's that tension again between the celebratory character, and this piece is even introduced as a song of praise and joy. Yet, musically, it probably isn't easy to hear it exactly that way. The opening stanza and movement of the cantata are also striking. It uses the chorale text and tune, of course, the melodies in the soprano, doubled by violin, oboe, and cornetto. Now, the material that supports that chorale tune in long notes is not the Italian instrumental concerto we usually expect in an opening movement of this, in this cycle of cantatas. It's a phrase-by-phrase setting of the chorale, with each entrance of the chorale line prepared by the entrance of the lower three voices, and each of those voices is doubled in turn by instruments, by the second violins, by the viola, and by basso continuo, and by the ensemble of three trombones that participate in this piece. Those entrances of the lower voices before the soprano melody comes in phrase by phrase anticipate the tune of the coming chorale phrase, and the lines imitate each other in that anticipation. And further, they interact as independent lines. They interact as so-called counterpoints. The independent lines you're supposed to hear as collectively making up the texture. There's no independent instrumental material in this movement. It's written out in old-fashioned musical notation, and Bach calls for the participation of cornetto and trombones, and this movement is the reason that they are called for in the piece, and they participate in the opening and closing movements. Those are all, for Bach and for the early 18th century, markers of old style. This is a so-called chorale motet. It harkens back to music of the 16th century, that is, to musical settings from the very first years of the Lutheran Reformation. For Bach, this tune by Luther kept its sense of antiquity, and that sense of antiquity is audible, reflected in old-fashioned musical style presented in the first movement. But it's not entirely that simple, once again. The stark, severe sound world of this opening motet is suggested by the tenor entrance in relatively long notes, borrowing material from the tune's first phrase in a very simple form, anticipating the even simpler presentation by the soprano in a few measures, and then by entrances of alto and bass in succession on that same material. That's normal for this sort of piece, but the opening tenor entrance is supported by a basso continuo line. Now that's typical for modern adaptations of motets like this, but that line strikingly is very active. It's decorated with fast notes. Its outline is ya-da-da-da, and that's pretty ordinary as a bass line. But that's not how Bach gives it to you. He gives it to you as ya da 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 da, and that level of motion, eight notes in the way this is notated as it happens, continues all the way through the piece, and it's not restricted to the basso continuo. It becomes quickly part of the texture of the lower three vocal lines. And the result is a far more animated texture than is typical for motets. Far more animated. This is arguably an modern elaboration of a very old musical type that brings this type some ways toward being more up to date. And I think, as a way to listen to it, it adds something of a festive character to the movement. Now, the expectation in Bach's Leipzig was for the second day of Christmas was a festive piece. Maybe not quite as festive as the kind of piece you'd have on the first day of Christmas, but not as sober as suggested by an antique motet doubled by cornetto and trombones on an ancient modal tune. The opening movement of Cantata 121, we might say then, is a festive motet, or at least a step in that direction, suited to the day, reflecting, to my ear, that tension in the cantata between the solemn and the celebratory. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, Yeah.
Thank you.